And so obviously I've seen some other of your shows, so and I think this one's slightly different. Like I've seen one before at the Tate where it was sort of like slightly fantasy exhibitions of different bits of the Tate's collection and sculpture that you put together and painted. And then I'd seen ones before where they were like exhibitions of famous artists around the world just before the exhibition was installed or just as it was being deinstalled. But I think that this one's slightly different, if you'd like to explain.
The sort of previous two or three exhibitions I've had, a series of works, were that, going to certain places around the world or travelling to fabrication studios where art was made.
Okay.
And I'd have a few hours there and I'd just be documenting artists' work being made, for example.
Okay.
And so the images were documentary in nature and it became a sort of typology, a collection of images of a particular theme.
Yeah.
And I had a sort of rule to myself before I even conceived of this exhibition. I wanted to reintroduce some element of fiction back into the work, like I had at the Tate show years ago. And I was thinking this, and I didn't know quite how that would come about.
Yeah.
I actually had a studio with this. Another artist came to sort of talk to me. And I have all these canvases in my studio from about 30 years ago. I think even from the Royal College when I was there. That I thought, one day I'm going to like do something huge.
I'm going to do a massive painting in 10 minutes.
But I've never known what that could be.
Yeah.
And this other artist, he joked with me, oh, if you did that, you'd probably take a photograph of yourself painting it and make a painting for that. And I had actually done something like that years ago, but that was the sort of initial sort of seed of the idea of creating a fictional space, or not so much fictional, because it is my space, with my genuine, you know, all the stuff in the studio filling the space.
Yeah.
And so the first one was just blank canvases in the area where I was going to about to start making these series of huge works and document myself making it. The idea sort of morphed into imagining myself as different sort of alternative versions of me, you know, photographer, conceptual artist, a sculptor.
That's really cool.
What it would be to be in the studio if that was the sort of artist I was. And without any of the works actually being made, it was just like a sort of inertia, or the kind of waiting for the moment of creation rather than the kind of, you know, seeing the finished works. And so all these works are like preparatory, you know, studios where the work preparing for making the work, you know.
So waiting for the moment of creation, that will also relate to like those, the paintings that you said more documentary, where it's exhibitions that are about to be.
Yeah. Well, it's that moment. I was very fascinated, you know, a partner, Kitty, she used to work in an art fabricator's.
Okay.
And there's two things about that. Obviously, the authorship of the artwork was spread over many makers, you know.
Yeah.
That was one thing I was interested in. But I was really interested in going to visit this amazing space with all these different technicians. There must be a moment when all this material turns into art.
Yeah.
So the sort of valueless becomes really valuable culturally and also in financial terms. But and so there's that moment when does the work of art begin and when's it just material?
Yeah.
So I was really interested in that in the fabrication series that I made. Because often it's just bits of metal on the ground that are going to be put together or haven't been polished up yet or painted or whatever. So, and in a way, I'm always like, sort of just before or just after is a really interesting moment for me. It's also kind of, sorry, so you could say it just came to my mind that it's also kind of a slight melancholy there. Which
absolutely.
Trying to about just having missed the boat or arrived too early and not knowing where it is.
No, but there's a poignancy in lots of the world. I'm always trying to think that moment where people are inspired or people see it happening, combined with the atmosphere of poignancy. It's weird, there's a kind of sadness to that moment of creativity in the world.
Well, it depends how you look at it, of course, but I suppose from my perspective, there's always been a kind of dichotomy about being an artist, because it's an act of faith to some degree.
Yeah.
In my case, it is.
Yeah.
And in a way, this sort of ritual of making it is this kind of trying to make it worth something. And whether the actual material object at the end, what happens to that, becomes, you know, a commercial item, or, you know, you might be lucky in, like I am, in having an exhibition, or you might go in the store cupboard. It's just this. Yeah. But the act of devotion that the artist has is quite important. I mean, I've thought about that, and it's also something, the sort of melancholy is also something I've noticed, that the technique I'm using of tempera painting from photographs, basically, creates a kind of stillness and a quietness to the image, which I think is not apparent in the original photographs. And so that I almost associate with a sort of melancholy atmosphere in the paintings as opposed to the photographs. So I try and make work, the content of which maps onto the kind of things that I notice happening by the technical operation of the medium, if you see what I mean. So
absolutely.
The melancholy is duplicated by the content of the image.
So for some unknown reason, the tempera work creates, it does create an extra stillness to those photos, an extra...
Yes, it's something that I didn't introduce deliberately.
Yeah.
It's something I've noticed, and I noticed it quite early on. And it's not something that I'd say, like everybody who works in paintings from photographs, it doesn't always automatically produce a stillness. You can be quite a bravado and flourishing. There's certain artists whose work is quite sort of noisy in a sense.
Yeah.
But I think the way I use an image is, and I had this rule just to copy as best I could, that's just the rule. It's kind of like turning myself into a robotic producer. The outcome of which interested me, because I was trying to sort of negate any sort of subjectivity, that there is a remainder there of me. And I used to think that that was the true me, because, you know, I was trying to show off or make it public. It was what was left, you know, when you get rid of everything else.
Absolutely.
And it was quite particular. I mean, I sort of would recognize my own work. Looking at what was left, it partly is this silence and this sort of melancholy, you know, it's a sort of temperament that's left in the work. Bomboclaat.